Thank you, Betsy, and thank you, Norma, for inviting me to teach this class. And Kathy, I'm in trouble if you're the room monitor. We met at the Christmas luncheon over at Skerrit Bennett, and she had me posing for crazy pictures within 5 minutes of meeting her. So we'll see how this goes. But this is a real honor for me to have a chance to lead this class for 6 weeks. I was with Perry Wallace last week in Washington, D.C., and he asked me to extend his best wishes to all of you and his thanks that you're taking this course. And in the last class of the session, we're going to do a Skype call with Perry, so everyone will have a chance to ask him questions directly. I'm really excited about that. Uncle Newt is here. Mom's all by herself over there in the corner. Hopefully she won't heckle me too bad, but she's taken, my parents moved to Nashville every other year, and my dad teaches two courses with the political science department here as an excuse to hang out with my kids, their grandkids. And so this is the every other year that they're here, and Norma's always been nice to hook my mom up with classes, and now she's taking mine. So, but one thing that Mom mentioned last year is that she took this class, and I said, well, what were they talking about? What was the subject? And I don't remember, I don't know if she remembered, but she said, but what she remembered the most was that the professor put up a picture of his sheepdog sitting in a swing. And that was a picture that stuck on her mind that, you know, she said, you've got to have some pictures. And I was like, well, Mom, we don't have a swing set and we don't have a dog, so I don't know what I'm going to show. So I thought that for her sake, I would have a good dog picture. So if nothing else, you all can leave here today and have seen a good dog picture. And then since this is a historic week as far as presidents go, I've got this picture as well. So you'll see where my political leanings lie. So this book was a real natural thing for me to do. I've been writing about sports since I was a little kid. And I found this the other day, which I made when I was 13 years old, was AJ's sports journal. And it wasn't for a class or school or anything. It was just something I did for fun. And I picked the American League East predictions. At that time, the Milwaukee Brewers, my favorite team, were in the East. So I picked them to win the division and go to the World Series. I think they finished 30 games under 500 that year. So I was wrong about that. And then I wrote an editorial about Bart Starr, who was the coach of the Green Bay Packers at the time and had just been fired, and they had a bad record. And I said, well, it's not the coach's fault. So I didn't really get sports at the time, I guess. And then my father was working at the Washington Post, and John Feinstein, who has now written tons of books, mostly about sports, was a Metro reporter covering city politics and government at the time, and I interviewed him. It's kind of fun to look back through that Q&A. So I came to Vanderbilt 5 years after this, as you know, as an 18-year-old freshman, had already been a kid that was always writing about sports. And so this is a picture of the very first paper that I ever wrote about Perry Wallace. When I arrived here, I grew up, was born in Madison, Wisconsin. I grew up in Washington, D.C. We moved to Austin, Texas when I was in high school. And one day my father was visiting Austin High, and he saw a poster on the wall advertising the Grantland Rice Fred Russell Sports Writing Scholarship to Vanderbilt. And I was the sports editor of the high school paper, Austin High Maroon. And he said, have you heard about this? And I hadn't. And so I put together an application, and that's how I ended up here at Vanderbilt, was on that scholarship. And Mr. Russell, of course, was still living at the time. I'm sure many of you knew him or certainly read his column. And every time I see his daughter Carolyn or his granddaughter Carrie, I thank them for setting the rest of the course of my life. Without that scholarship, I wouldn't have come here. I was going to go to McAllister College in St. Paul, Minnesota. But so thankful that I ended up here at Vanderbilt. And so in 1989, I was a sophomore. This is the first semester of my sophomore year. And that was the first year that Perry Wallace was ever invited back to this campus to be recognized for what he did as a pioneer in the SEC. You know, he graduated the year I was born, 1970. And it was almost 20 years before he was ever invited back. And so it just happened to be when I was here as a student that he comes back to campus for the first time and there's media coverage of his visit here. And so I was reading about this person. I was at a school. I didn't grow up knowing anything about Vanderbilt. I didn't know anything about Perry Wallace. I'd never heard of him before. But there was a kid who was a year ahead of me at Vanderbilt named Dave Shinen. And if any of you are from the D.C. area, he's now a columnist for the Washington Post. But he was a year ahead of me at Vanderbilt. He wrote an article recognizing Perry's return to Nashville, talking about the first game that Perry Wallace ever played down in Starkville, Mississippi, as a freshman in 1967. And this is, you may remember back when they had freshman teams and varsity teams. So Perry was a member of the Vanderbilt freshman team, along with Godfrey Dillard. Godfrey Dillard had come down from Detroit, the other African-American player on the Vanderbilt freshman team, the first two African-American basketball players in the SEC. And this article that Dave wrote described the scene at the gym in Starkville. And it talked about the death threats that Godfrey and Perry received before the trip, the fact that there were students there, you know, shaking the bus when they arrived in Starkville, and the scene at the game where they're hearing every epithet in the book and having Cokes poured on them and being spit on. And at halftime of this basketball game, these two 18-year-old kids, strong young athletes, are holding hands in the locker room to gain the courage to go back out and play the second half of the basketball game. And so that was the first I ever heard of Perry. And I was here on a sports writing scholarship, a history major, and this story just grabbed me right away. And so I was taking a black history course at the time, and I didn't realize at the time this class existed because of Perry and Godfrey getting the ball rolling for it back in the late 60s. But Dr. Yolette Jones was my teacher. She's now a dean here in the College of Arts and Science. And I asked her if it was okay to write about sports in college. And I thought that she was going to say, no, you know, this is Vanderbilt University. This is not a serious academic subject. You can't write about sports. But thankfully, she said, yes, if that's what you're interested in, you know, follow your interest. And Perry and I were speaking at a school in D.C. last week. And the next thing I mentioned, the kids couldn't believe, but I told them that the web had not been invented yet at the time. And so I had to find Perry through the phone book. And they're like, what's a phone book, you know? So he was a professor at the University of Baltimore at the time. And I just called him out of the blue from my dorm at Carmichael Towers here on campus and interviewed him for this paper. And it was called When You See a Purple Man. And my book was almost going to be called When You See a Purple Man until the publisher said, that makes no sense. Don't call your book that. But that was a phrase that Perry used in describing just how bizarre his experience was, where he was seeing the racism that was very obviously being directed at him. And it seemed like his teammates and coaches and other students on campus were not acknowledging it. And he said, it's as if you were walking down the street and there's this purple man walking towards you and you're the only one that sees it. And you start to wonder if you're the one who's a little crazy. You know. And so it was a profound statement that Perry had made, and that was the title of my paper. This is Perry when he was a kid at Elliott Elementary School, which is over in the Germantown area. If you've been to Germantown Cafe, it's very close to that intersection there. And when I wrote this paper about Perry as a college student, I focused mainly on the sports aspect of his story because I was a sports nut. You know, I was the type that only read the sports section of the newspaper, or ESPN was the only channel that I watched. I loved Memorial Gym. I loved Vanderbilt basketball. And so I focused on what was your experience like as a player? What was Coach Skinner like to you? How were your teammates? What was the environment like on the road? But it wasn't until I started working on this book that I realized that Perry's story is so much more than a sports story. It's a legitimate civil rights story. And that's what I hope makes it, elevates it beyond a typical sports book. It makes it a book that anybody, whether you're into basketball or sports, or not, will appreciate and get something out of. And so it became very obvious to me as I was doing the research for the book that I could tell a much bigger story than just a basketball pioneering story. And I spent 8 years working on the book, by the way. So I started in 2006 when I was working at a public relations firm here in Nashville. This was before I had met Newt's niece, Allison. So we weren't married yet. I didn't have kids yet. had a little less responsibility at my job, and so I had time after work. And so this was a project I did at night and on weekends outside of my job. And I spent 4 years just on the research side, and then another 4 writing. So during that 4 years on the research side, I learned a lot about Perry's life here in Nashville. He was born in 48, so mainly in the 50s and 60s. And you think about how neatly his life tracks with key moments or key figures in the civil rights movement. So he started kindergarten at Elliott Elementary in 1954, year of Brown versus Board of Education. He was a 12-year-old kid in 1960 when the sit-ins were happening at the lunch counters in downtown Nashville. And he told me that he and a couple of his friends, who he lived in North Nashville, fairly close to where the Titans practice bubble, Luby Community Center area, Metro Center area, they would walk over downtown to Fifth Avenue and watch the sit-ins. They wanted to see it with their own eyes as 12-year-old kids. And he said his parents would have killed them if they knew what they were up to. But he really wanted to see these students from TSU and Fisk protesting the lunch counters. In 1963, Perry enters Pearl High School in late August, about a week after Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech. He's at Pearl in 64 and 65 when the Voting Rights Act, which is pictured here, or the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act are passed. And what Perry told me is that with all of these events happening, he and his friends felt that times were changing and that there would be opportunities coming and that he would need to be prepared to take advantage of the opportunities that were there that hadn't been there. Perry had 4 older sisters, the youngest of which was 10 years older than Perry. So there would be doors opening that hadn't been there for Perry's older siblings. He had an older brother that went off to the Air Force as well. And so he wanted to be prepared. And Perry was prepared. That's him in the middle, this picture of the Pearl High Tigers. And I have that rim, actually. They ripped it down. These 3 guys went up after one of their teammates missed the layup. They were all up on the rim at the same time to dunk it back in, and they ripped the rim down before they had the breakaway rims. And his classmates from Pearl High School gave it to him last year. They had saved this rim all these years as a symbol of the strength of the class of 1966. And so Perry was here for an event over at MLK Magnet School, which is the building where Pearl High School used to be. And they presented it to him, and he was getting on a Southwest flight back to D.C. And he said, "Andrew, I really don't want to take a rim as a carry-on on this flight." So I have it at my house. So Perry was a star basketball player. And Pearl High was the best team in the state. Back in those days, the high school leagues were segregated. So as a sophomore and junior, Perry's teams won the Black Tennessee High School State Championship. His senior year was the first year that the TSSAA tournament included black high schools and predominantly white high schools, and they went undefeated and won the state championship that year. And Perry was the best dunker on a team where every single player, including the shortest point guard on the team, could dunk the basketball. They would save Perry for last in the pregame warm-ups. And his teammates told me about these incredible reverse dunks or tomahawk dunks that he would do, and he would bring the house down at their games. But he was also a great student. He was the valedictorian of his class at Pearl High. He loved math and science were his favorite subjects. He played the trumpet. And actually, when he moved from middle school to high school, even though he was 6'5" and could dunk, his plan was just to be in the band at Pearl High. He didn't know how you tried out for the basketball team. The band teacher at Pearl had already made contact with him, and so he was all ready to be in the band until the coach, Coach Ridley, realized there's a 6'5 kid in the band who could dunk, and he's like, "You've got to be on the basketball team." But that was, Perry said that would have been just fine with him, just to play in the band. His older sisters, I mentioned, all had gone to a college at TSU or Fisk, and this is on the salaries, the income. His father, Perry Sr., was a bricklayer, and his mom, Hattie, was the cleaning lady at the Benny Dillon building in downtown Nashville. And yet they put 4 sisters through college. He's taught Sunday school. Schrader Lane Church of Christ was the Wallace family's church, and his mom was there every Sunday, and that was very important to Perry at the time. But you can see all the other class awards. Mr. Esquire was sort of the most popular student at the school. And so Perry was a real Renaissance kid. And his life was full of things besides just basketball. And he actually saw basketball as a means to an end. It wasn't just, you know, the main thing for him. His goal was to earn a scholarship to a school that would get him out of the South and get him out of segregation and Jim Crow. And he told me stories about one time he and his mom came downtown to go shopping, and they were taking the bus home, and as she's paying, he just takes a seat up front. And she saw him sitting there and pulled him to the back, and he didn't understand why. And that was the time he got the talk from his mom about why he wasn't allowed to sit in the front of the bus. And so, you know, he experienced all those types of things, not being able to try on clothes when they would come downtown to go shopping, or having to go in the back doors of certain restaurants or theaters, and just experiencing segregation and discrimination. So his goal was to get out of here, and he could have. He was, his sights were set on a scholarship to a Big Ten school. So he went on recruiting visits to Northwestern, Wisconsin, Michigan, Iowa, Purdue, even UCLA recruited Perry. And this was when John Wooden was their coach, when they were winning other national championships in the 1960s. And UCLA had recruited a player from Pearl a few years earlier named Ronnie Lawson. So they were familiar with the program. There was a school, Loyola of Chicago, that had won the national championship in, I think, 1963 with two Pearl players starting for them. And so this school had a great tradition. Coaches around the country knew if you were a good player at Pearl, you were going to be a good college basketball player. And so that opportunity was there for Perry until he starts to go on these trips. And what he thought was his dream sort of comes crashing down. And Perry's a real straight arrow whose academics are very important to him. And when he goes on the trips, he sees sort of the ugly side of college basketball that you still see too often today. So he is offered cars, which is against the rules. He's offered townhouses. They'll say, you know, here's your girlfriend for the weekend. Here's some cash to tide you over. And most significant to him, most disappointing to him, he was told, if you come here, we'll find the easiest classes for you, or really, you don't even have to take classes. You're just here to play basketball. And Perry was an engineer here at Vanderbilt, but I think he's a poet at heart. And so the phrase that he used in telling me this story was that he wasn't going to trade one plantation for another. And he wasn't going to leave the Deep South just to be exploited for his athletic ability at one of these northern schools. And so all of a sudden, Vanderbilt sort of comes in to the picture, which is unusual when you consider his whole life growing up. He would have been excluded from this university. He was only integrated undergraduate student body in 1964. So his whole life, he never thought about coming here. He didn't follow the Vanderbilt basketball team or ever think about coming to school here, even though he grew up just a couple miles away. And the reason that Vanderbilt all of a sudden is interested in recruiting Perry, when no other school in the SEC has ever recruited a black basketball player, and the first black athletes in any sport were a baseball player at Tulane, which was on its way out of the SEC at the time, and two black football players at Kentucky that same fall semester that Perry enrolls. But Vanderbilt's interest in changing things goes back to the same 1960 lunch counter sit-ins that Perry had watched as a 12-year-old. And the picture here is Reverend James Lawson being arrested in Nashville. And he was a Vanderbilt Divinity School student at the time that he was teaching the principles of nonviolence to the students at TSU and Fisk and the American Baptist Bible College. And when the administration here at Vanderbilt learned that it was one of its own students organizing the lunch counter protests, they didn't thank Reverend Lawson, who's gone on to become one of the great unsung heroes of the civil rights movement. They expelled him from the university. And so this was at a time when Vanderbilt was looking to become known as more of a national institution rather than just a strong southern school. And the national media attention that came after the expulsion of Reverend Lawson was very negative, as you could imagine. And so this was a low point in the university's history. And in response to that, a new chancellor is brought in, Alexander Hurd, who's on the right here. You guys recognize the person in the middle. So Chancellor Hurd had come from the University of North Carolina. He was considered more of a New South type of figure, a progressive figure in the South at the time. And his daughter, Connie Hurd, is now a professor at Blair School here. So I interviewed her for the book, and I actually got a chance to meet Chancellor Hurd also before he passed away at his home, and he could not communicate, but Connie told me that his eyes told her that he recognized what I was telling him, you know, that I admired him and that I was writing this book, and so it was a really special moment to meet Chancellor Hurd. But in the 1960s, if you go back and look at his speeches, he talked often about race being the central issue facing the country at the time. And also, Connie told me that he was a big sports fan. And a lot of people didn't realize that, but he loved baseball, especially. She said he was a walking baseball encyclopedia. And the old Philadelphia Athletics were his favorite baseball team. But, you know, within a few weeks of him becoming chancellor, he's already given speeches on campus related to race and related to sports. And so he understood the role that sports plays in American culture. For better or worse. And so he understood that if he made a move in the sports sphere of things on campus, that people would take notice of that, and they would understand that Vanderbilt was making moves to change. And so he called Roy Skinner, the basketball coach, into his office, and he said, "Roy, you know, we've integrated the school 2 years ago. You can recruit a black player, and in fact, I would like you to." And so right across town, you had Perry Wallace, who, you know, was a starting center on a three-time state champion team, valedictorian of his class. And so he became the obvious choice to recruit to Vanderbilt. And so the only question was, did Perry want to do it? And really, he really didn't want to. He didn't want to be a pioneer. He had a sense, a little bit of a sense, of how difficult this challenge would be to be all alone, traveling through Alabama and Mississippi and Louisiana. But you know, he's been disappointed by his recruiting trips to these other places. On his visits to Vanderbilt, he's been impressed. He's seen the players actually going to class. Imagine that. Yeah. When I talk to basketball teams, they don't laugh at that part. he's impressed by the engineering school, and Clyde Lee, who's been the star of the 1965 team, the best team in Vanderbilt history, is the one that has showed him around campus. And so Perry's gotten a good vibe, actually, from Vanderbilt, which he didn't really anticipate. And so one day, I mentioned the 4 years of researching the book. Perry flew back down to Nashville, and we just spent the day driving around town. And I got to see Perry Wallace's 1950s, 1960s Nashville. And at one point, we were over by his old house behind the baseball field at the Luby Community Center. And he said, "Pull the car over here. I want to show you something. Look at those rocks and trees over there." And that's all it was rocks and trees. And so I didn't understand what was significant about this. But he said, "Look at that rock over there. That's where I sat and prayed over my decision whether I was going to come to Vanderbilt or not." And he did. So this is one of my favorite pictures that I found for the book here at the archives, University Archives. And that's Perry's father, Perry Sr., and his mom, Hattie, you know, all dressed up. And Perry shaking Coach Skinner's hand in the lobby at Memorial Gym. And that's Clyde Lee pictured behind them. And so you kind of see, I think I write this in the book, like old school basketball in that picture there with his crew cut and his foot firmly on the ground, you know. And Perry is representing this new brand of basketball, and he's going to be... They said he could jump so high he could pick a quarter up off the top of the rim, or the backboard. And so this is the historic moment where Vanderbilt basketball, SEC basketball, and really college basketball is changed when Perry makes this decision to come to Vanderbilt. So he comes. And Perry has a phrase that he uses today that we can all treat each other in any of three ways. You can be treated well, you can be treated poorly, or you cannot be treated at all. And I thought that was a pretty profound way to look at life, and I'd never thought of it that way before. But Perry begins to experience all three of these types of treatment from the very beginning, even before his first day of class. So in terms of being treated well, Chancellor Hurd, you know, had encouraged Coach Skinner to recruit him, and he'll often call Perry into his office at Kirkland Hall and ask him how things are going personally for him and also for other African-American students on campus. Bev Asbury is the university chaplain at the time. It's Some of you probably knew him or know him. And he was very gracious to Perry, and also would call him into his office or have him out to his house and have dinner and just have a chance to socialize and relax and talk about the issues of the day, which Perry really appreciated. There were only probably 25 or so black students on campus at the time. You know, going back to the freshmen that entered in 1964, who were part of the first wave of students. And so it was a small group, but Perry told me a tight-knit group, and they formed the first Afro-American Student Association on campus. And even from Perry's freshman year, this group of students recognized the sort of the stature that came with being a basketball player. So Perry was, even though he was mistreated quite often, within that group, he was sort of a big man on campus. And so when they would go to meet Chancellor Hurd in his office, it was Perry, even as a freshman, that would lead the group into the office. There were some students, white students, that had come from other parts of the country and integrated high schools and made an effort to reach out to Perry or other African-American students. But for the most part, these pockets of support were few and far between. So the second way Perry says you can be treated is to be treated poorly. And he experienced a lot of that, even before his first day of class. So he arrived on campus in early August to get moved into his dorm and learn his way around campus and meet some professors. He knew he'd be very busy once classes and basketball started, so he wanted to get some of these things out of the way. And he remembered a tour of campus that Clyde Lee had given him when Perry was a high school senior. And Clyde and Perry had both grown up in the Church of Christ here in Nashville. Clyde grew up in the Lipscomb area and attended a white church, Perry in North Nashville, Schrader Lane Church of Christ, a black church, but they're both Church of Christ. And so on this tour of campus, as Clyde Lee is showing Perry around the perimeter of the school, he says, here's the University Church of Christ. This is where you should go when you arrive here on campus. And if you've been around Nashville a while, you remember where the IHOP used to be over at that intersection where you always get an accident. You know, that crazy intersection over by Mellow Mushroom is now, and there's a solar parking lot there. That's where the University Church of Christ used to be located. And Perry said that as an African-American kid growing up in Nashville, he never would have walked into a white church, but that apparently times were changing, and this is what being a pioneer was all about, and Clyde Lee said to go here, so he was going to give it a shot. There was no Governor Wallace standing at the church door, you know, keeping him out. And so he gives it a shot. And so for 3 weeks that August, he goes to the church and he takes a seat in the back. And he's either left alone or ignored, depending how you want to look at it. And then the fourth week, he walks into the church and some church members call him aside to a side room. And they say, Perry, we're not racist, but you can't keep coming here anymore. They say there's older members of the church who say they will write the church out of their wills if we allow you to keep coming. And so you can't keep coming. And in fact, you have to leave right now. And so he walks back to Kissam Quadrangle, where his freshman room was, takes off his coat and tie. And before his first day of class at Vanderbilt, he's been kicked out of church. His best friend at Pearl High School was Walter Murray. And on the freshman quad now, there's Murray Dormitory, named after Walter Murray. He later became the first African-American member of the Board of Trust here at Vanderbilt. But he and Perry had been best friends at Pearl. Really smart kid. He was the salutatorian at Pearl High School and Perry was the valedictorian. And his first day of English class, he walks into the classroom and the professor looks at him and says, oh, so I see they've let the N-word in after all. And that's how Walter Murray is greeted to class. A woman named Eileen Carpenter, who grew up here in Nashville, African-American woman, what was the Catholic girls' school here in the 60s? St. Cecilia. So she had gone there. And I think it was St. Cecilia that she went to. So she had gone to school there. She's from Nashville. And she told me that as her parents dropped her off from their home, they lived in the Whites Creek area, she walks into her classroom and sort of hears the Twilight Zone music playing. And she takes a seat in the front row of her class and notices that nobody else sits in that row with her, and nobody else sits in the row behind her. So she's feeling this sense of isolation and feeling invisible right away. Another African-American woman student told me about going into her science class, and I can't remember if it was chemistry or biology class, but she said whoever sat next to you became your lab partner in the class. And so she was there, and but what if no one chooses to sit next to you? You know, and so she walked student after student come in and sit somewhere else. And so that's this feeling that these African-American students are feeling on campus. On the basketball court, Perry was experiencing this poor treatment as well. So his freshman year, University of Mississippi, Ole Miss, cancels both of its games against Vanderbilt that year, claiming they had discovered schedule conflicts. Conveniently, only against Vanderbilt twice during the same season. So nobody believed that, and it was obvious they didn't want to play against a team that happened to have the first black players in the league. So it's not until Perry's sophomore year that he becomes the first African-American player ever to play a game in Oxford, Mississippi. And his black teammate from his freshman year, Godfrey Dillard, by that time, or that year, he's injured. So Perry makes the trip alone. And in the first half of the game, he takes an elbow to the face. And his teammate, one of his white teammates from Vanderbilt, told me that Bill LaFever, some of you may know him in town, photographer, architect, told me it was definitely an intentional shot to the face. And so Perry's bleeding from his nose. He can't see out of one of his eyes. He's dizzy, and the referees don't even call a foul or whistle a stop to the game for the team trainer to come out and assist Perry. And so it's not until the next time the ball happens to roll out of bounds that the trainer and the student manager are able to come out to help Perry. And I talked to the manager, Paul Wilson, and he told me that as he walked with Perry from the court to the Vanderbilt locker room so they could get him a bag of ice, the crowd stood up and cheered the fact that Perry had been injured, and as they're walking into the tunnel to the locker room, they're getting pelted with liquids. He doesn't know what they were. But the other interesting thing about that episode, and it illustrates this, people say, how were Perry's teammates to him? And Perry will always go to great lengths to say that his teammates were good guys, and they were just 18, 19, 20-year-old kids themselves. They weren't experienced civil rights leaders, you know, how much can you expect of kids when adults haven't even figured this issue out yet? He'll always say that. He defends his teammates, always. But at halftime of this game, as the halftime clock runs out, Perry's been sitting on the training table, he's received his ice, the clock's running out for the start of the second half to start, everybody leaves. They all run back out onto the court for the basketball game to begin in the second half. All the players, all the coaches, the trainer, and the student managers. And so Perry's left on this training table alone, knowing that he's going to have to walk back out through that tunnel where the Ole Miss fans are waiting on him. And they've been harassing him the whole game. He's going to be coming out alone. And they're saying, where's the end? Did he go home? You know, where is he? And so Perry said what would have been an ordinary walk back to the bench for any other player on the team was a long, hellish trauma for him. Just think about that. You know, just walking back, simple act of walking back from the locker room to the bench was a long, hellish trauma, he said, for him. And he said if his teammates really, or coaches, had understood what he was going through, at least one person would have waited and made that walk back with him. But he did it. And I asked him, in general, how did he approach these road trips that he knew he was going to be making before each season to Tuscaloosa and Oxford and Starkville and Gainesville and Athens, Baton Rouge, Knoxville and Lexington. I think that was all the schools then. So he said that he would look at the schedule with the deepest sense of dread, and that he would imagine what's the worst thing that could happen on one of these trips. And in his mind, it was that he would be shot and killed, either out on the court during a game or around town before or after one of these games. And when he first mentioned that to me, I honestly had a hard time believing it. You know, I've never heard of a player being shot and killed during a game. Hopefully that never happens. But the more I thought about it, and the more he explained it to me, you think about while he's in college, Martin Luther King and Robert F. Kennedy are assassinated, and certainly they probably had more protection around them than Perry Wallace would have. So easily he could have been shot and killed during a basketball game. Yeah, he still had the courage to get on the plane, step out on the court, Vanderbilt on his chest, representing our school, you know, and try to play an ordinary basketball game like everybody else. I'll come back to that in a second. So he does it. He never quits. And one other story, if there's any hardcore basketball fans in here, this is my most basketball-y type of story. So in terms of being treated poorly, I mentioned in high school, he was a great dunker. In college, okay, while he's growing up in Nashville, he's 12 years old. The guy that really sort of teaches him how to dunk, after he has seen Wilt Chamberlain come to Nashville for an exhibition game with the old Philadelphia Warriors. They played an exhibition game, I think, at Fisk. And Perry saw this, and he wanted to grow up to be able to dunk just like Wilt Chamberlain. He starts playing in pickup games at TSU in the summer. And so even as a 12, 13-year-old kid, he's playing basketball with the college players from TSU. And one summer, one of those players, his name is David Latton. And I don't know if you've heard of David Latton, but Perry described him as this ferocious dunker, better than Wilt or Michael Jordan or anybody he'd ever later seen. And so Perry is sort of taught how to dunk by David Latton. David Latton transfers from TSU to Texas Western before he's ever even played a game at TSU. And Texas Western is the team that beats Kentucky in the 1966 NCAA championship game, the game that the movie Glory Road is made about. And it was a historic game. Texas Western had only played African-American players in that game. They did have white players on their team, but they didn't play. And Kentucky, Adolph Rupp, was still all white. And so when Texas Western wins that national championship game in 66, it's a historic moment in college basketball, watershed game. And the other interesting thing about that night, that game was on March 19th, 1966. That's the same night that Perry's Pearl High School team, all-black team from Nashville, beats all-white team Memphis Treadwell for the state championship in Tennessee. So I had a lot of fun writing a chapter about both of these historic events happening at the very same time, basically. But in that 1966 NCAA championship game, early in the game, David Latton dunks the ball over Pat Riley, Kentucky player who later becomes the coach of the Lakers and now runs the Miami Heat. And it really sets the tone in this early in this game. This is a different style of basketball than Kentucky's used to, and it embarrasses Adolph Rupp. Well, the very next year is Perry Wallace's freshman year on the Vanderbilt team. And then Vanderbilt goes up to Lexington to play Kentucky. Perry is sort of the second coming of David Latton. He's been taught to dunk by David Latton, who has just embarrassed Kentucky. And early in this freshman game in Lexington, Perry dunks it over Dan Issel, who's the star of the Kentucky freshman team, who you guys have heard of. He goes on to play in the NBA, a great player in the NBA. And Perry said as he ran back down the court after this dunk, he could see this old man going crazy on the sideline complaining, and it was Adolph Rupp. And so during the off season between that freshman year and Perry's first year on the Vanderbilt varsity team, Adolph Rupp, who is biggest figure in college basketball and on the rules committee, they outlaw the slam dunk in college basketball. And at the time it was called the Alcindor rule, shorthand, you know, as if it was only directed at UCLA and Lou Alcindor, who becomes Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, and the championships they were winning and the way Kareem was changing the game. And no one ever talks about Perry Wallace, but I do in the book, and I say that Adolph Rupp wasn't going to play Lou Alcindor in UCLA unless they met in the tournament. But he was going to be playing Vanderbilt twice a year for the next 3 years, and this new David Latton, Perry Wallace, is coming into his league. And so I don't think it was just a coincidence that this rules change happens. And so Perry has to play his varsity career without the benefit of his best move. He has to really learn how to shoot the ball, which he said made him a better player. He has a positive way of looking at everything. But, you know, he says there's these three ways you can be treated: to be treated well, treated poorly, and the third way is to not be treated at all. And Perry told me that that was actually the most difficult part of his experience. It wasn't getting hit in the face or the verbal abuse that he took on the basketball court, because basketball season was just 20-something games over a few months a year. It was this sense of isolation and loneliness that he felt on the Vanderbilt campus, this not being treated at all, which was every minute of every hour of every day for entire school years for 4 years. And that was the most difficult part of his experience. He said during those 4 years, and the most difficult thing for him to deal with in the years after he left Vanderbilt, the sense that he had been denied his humanity as a student here. But he doesn't quit. He had grown up as a student of Jackie Robinson. He used to walk over to the Hadley Park Library in North Nashville when he was a kid, and he would read books about Jackie Robinson. His mom, I mentioned, church was so important to her, and her advice to Perry was to put on the full armor of God, and that's what will protect you in the most difficult circumstances. And so Perry is very, very close to his mother, being the youngest kid by a long shot. He was a real mama's boy, you know. But she passes away before his senior year. And it's very difficult for Perry, although he said in some an ironic way for him, it kind of freed him up without having some of the pressure that came with trying to please his mom all the time. But he dedicates the last game of his career to his mom, Hattie. And it's here at Memorial Gym in March 1970, about a week after I was born. And he dedicates this game to his mom. And he plays the game of his life. He had 27 points and 28 rebounds by himself, which is as many rebounds as a team might get in some games. And he saves the best for last. So his last basket of his college career is an illegal slam dunk. And he saved it for the last minute of the game. He dunks it. And the referee should have called it off. You know, by the rules of the time, it was an illegal shot. But for some reason, they let it stand. And if there's ever a movie made about this book, I could see that dunk as sort of the triumphant ending of the book. And it could have been the triumphant farewell for Perry. His last game here in Nashville, he gets the dunk. He's played a great game for his mom. But Perry is not the kind of person that's going to let it go that easily. And he said as he walked off the court after that game, as he gets a standing ovation, that he had an uneasy feeling in the pit of his stomach that there was still a lot of unfinished business, and that the Vanderbilt community and the white community in Nashville in particular were too quick to want to wrap up this story and say, okay, we've integrated our team, we've integrated or desegregated, better word, the SEC, and there's nothing more to learn here. We've done it. And Perry knew there were still a lot of unanswered questions and that his experience had been very difficult. There was only one other African-American basketball player in the entire league, even 4 years into his career. There was no black player on the way to the Vanderbilt team. It was hard for him to see what progress had actually been made. His experience on campus had been difficult. And so even at this moment where he's the most popular that he's ever been, he decides to make a move that will make him as unpopular as he's ever been. And he knows it's going to do that. And it's just telling the truth. I think the most courageous thing he did wasn't getting on a plane to Mississippi. It was just telling the truth to the Tennessean the day after his last game. He talks to Frank Sutherland, who was just a young reporter at the paper at the time, later becomes the editor of the Tennessean. And he goes over to Frank's apartment, which is on Love Circle, and talks about his experience. And Perry said he felt he had a moral obligation to the people that would come behind him to tell the truth about what his experience had been like. And he wasn't trying to complain. He was just trying to, for the benefit of students and the university, talk about what his experience had been like so that people could learn from it. And so he talks about being kicked out of the church. He tells Frank about what his professor had said to Walter Murray. He talks about how he was treated on the road. And mostly he talks about the sense of isolation and loneliness that he felt on the campus. You know, at the time, the Greek system completely dominated the social scene here, but all the fraternities and sororities would not admit any black members, and they didn't even have the black fraternities and sororities like they do on campus now. So there are very few social outlets if you're an African-American student at the time, and he talks about that. And I talked to, and Perry says in giving this interview, he suspected he was writing his ticket out of town, and that even though he had been three-time state champion high school basketball player, valedictorian of a Nashville high school, an all-SEC basketball player at Vanderbilt, team captain, voted Bachelor of Ugliness, if any of you are old Vandy alums, that was the award for the most popular male student on campus at the time. All of that, by all rights, should set you up for a career in your hometown. You know, he had done everything right all along the way here. But he said that if he told the truth, people weren't going to want to hear it And so he understood what the reaction might be to this story. And so I talked to Mr. Siegenthaler, who was still living when I was researching the book, and Frank Sutherland, and they said that Perry was right. So the day the story runs, it runs on the front page of that Monday paper, and the phones rang off the hook at the Tennessean with Vanderbilt fans calling to cancel their subscriptions to the paper, or criticizing Perry, calling him ungrateful after all Vanderbilt had done for him, they would say, and wishing Perry good riddance out of town. And so Perry was right about what this reaction might be. And so he graduates in May with his degree in engineering, which he's very proud of, and is drafted by two teams. He's drafted by the Kentucky Colonels of the old ABA and the Philadelphia 76ers of the NBA. And he said that, you know, in high school he had wanted to get out of the South, but he stayed. This time he said he had no question about which team he was going to go to. It wasn't the Kentucky Colonels, it was the Philadelphia 76ers, even though he had much less of a shot of making the Sixers roster. Dr. Jack Ramsey was their coach, a great coach who later won championships with the Portland Trail Blazers, was an ESPN announcer into his 90s. He just passed away a couple years ago. And he was Dr. Jack Ramsey. He was a really highly educated person, and he admired Perry for being a serious student and not just a basketball player. And so even though Perry Wallace didn't make the Sixers roster, Jack Ramsey took a real interest in him. And he said, if you ever want to go to law school, I'll write your letter of recommendation. And he found a minor league roster spot for Perry with the Wilmington Blue Bombers in Wilmington, Delaware, near Philadelphia, which was a team that wasn't even affiliated with Philadelphia 76ers, but Ramsey got him this roster spot. And during the day, Perry lived in Philadelphia, and he taught at an inner-city high school. An unusual guy, trying to start his basketball career, he's also teaching during the day as a sort of semi-permanent math teacher at this school, and he also volunteers to help coach the basketball team. And Bartram High School had had a star player years earlier, Earl the Pearl Monroe, and as Perry's helping to coach the team, there's an eighth grader that's a pretty good ball player. His name was Joe Bryant, and his nickname is Jelly Bean, and his son's name is Kobe. And so Perry coached Kobe Bryant's dad as a high school player. And so Perry does that for a year. He's also serving, he joined the National Guard, so he's in the early years of his six-year commitment to the Guard. After a year of that, he works for the National Urban League, for Ron Brown is the person who hires him, you know, later well-known Democratic figure. And then Perry does go to Columbia University Law School. One of his letters of recommendation was from Chancellor Hurd, and the other was from an NBA basketball coach, Dr. Jack Ramsey. And so Perry's at Columbia University Law School. Eric Holder was a year ahead of him there. Perry earns the Charles Evans Hughes Fellowship, which is for law students interested in social justice. He interns with Jack Greenberg, who had been an associate of Thurgood Marshall. And so Perry, the reason he went to law school, having graduated with an engineering degree, is his experience at Vanderbilt showed him he wanted to do something that would be meaningful to other people. And he saw the law as the way to do that. He takes a job with the Justice Department and is an attorney for the Justice Department for 7 years, and then becomes a professor. And I mentioned that the first time I interviewed him, he was a professor at the University of Baltimore. And then he moves on to American University, where he still is today. So Perry is 68 years old. He'll be 69 next month. Hasn't retired, still teaching at American. And when my book came out in December 2014, the first event that we did together was at Politics and Prose bookstore in D.C., which is their great independent bookstore there. And it was a very welcoming environment. My parents lived most of the year in D.C., so they were there. Perry's family was there. All of his law school colleagues were there. And so it couldn't have been a more supportive crowd. But the next day, we were headed back down to Nashville. And Perry said, I think we're headed into a hot environment down there. And it was December, so he didn't mean the weather. You know, and he was remembering the last time, he's been here since then, but the last time he really told his story was in that interview in 1970. And he remembered the reception that he got then, and so he was really curious, what's it going to be like this time? And me having now lived here since I came here as a freshman in 1988, I love Nashville, and I've read all the stories about this being the friendliest place in the world, you know, and believe that. And so I was hoping that Perry would experience this new Nashville, but we didn't know. And so we spoke together, I'll change this, at the downtown library. And there's an auditorium there that seats 250 people, and 400 people showed up. And so they had 150 people across the hall watching on TV, and we spoke for a little over an hour. And afterwards, people lined up to get their books signed. And a few people wanted me to sign their books. Everybody wanted Perry to sign their books. And so I had an opportunity to watch these interactions between Perry and these people. And they were mostly people in their 60s. And it turned out they had been classmates of Perry here at Vanderbilt, class of 1970. And if you've read the book, the first page is about one of his old teammates coming back and asking for forgiveness. And this was the scene that was playing out over and over again at the downtown library that night, where I noticed people were crying or they had bloodshot eyes, and they were had just heard Perry talk about his experience really for the first time. And they were saying, I wish that I had been paying attention back then. I wish I had been supportive of you back then. You're a hero. Please forgive me. So it was a very emotional scene. And it's one that's played out over and over again since then. And I just show these two pictures to show, and it's okay, I asked Perry about that. And I said, when you gave this interview in 1970, nobody wanted to hear it. You're telling the same stories now and everyone loves you. You know, how do you explain that? And he said that he just had faith back then. He understood that back then people weren't going to want to hear it for the most part. But he said that he had faith the way times change and people change, that if he just continued to tell the truth, that someday people would understand. You know, and so I've felt like ever since then, when I go around telling his story, or people read the book, or they see Perry, we're all the people he's been waiting on for like 50 years now. You know, so it's really, it's always emotional. But, you know, so he continued just to live this good life, tell the truth, and now finally, he had this sense of delayed gratification. You know, it's coming now. So that's Mayor Dean in the middle there, and that's Perry's sister, Jessie, who's a longtime teacher in Memphis. When Perry came back to town, he was greeted by the police chief and the mayor, which was symbolic, you know. And this here is Simone Charlie, who is probably the best student athlete at Vanderbilt right now. She's a star track athlete and soccer player. And when Perry came back to campus, she made a point of coming over to meet him and thanking him for, you know, opening doors that made her experience here as a student athlete possible. And so Perry is really enjoying this new, he's not the type that goes around beating his chest or telling his story that often unless you ask him about it. But since the book came out, we've had a chance to travel around the country. Really, we were just in D.C. at a school last week. We're going to Atlanta together soon. And especially having a chance to talk to young people. When we were at the school in D.C. last week, he had never met any of these kids before. But he said, I did what I did for you. You know, and he was looking out at this school that was very diverse. Black kids and white kids all mixed up together and getting along. And he said, this is what I had in mind. This is why I did this. And he started to cry. And they got a standing ovation from the crowd. It was terrific. And I've had some fun experiences with the book as well. So that's Chuck Todd up there. I was on Meet the Press as part of my press tour. And the fun thing, my dad has now walked in the room. We already joked that Mom's here and Uncle Newt's here too. So my dad's written 12 books. He's been on that show many, many times. But the great thing was, when I was interviewed by Chuck Todd, he kept mispronouncing my last name. He was saying Maraniss instead of Maraniss. And so I was thinking, before it went to commercial, do I tell him that he's not saying it right, or I just let it go? And so I stood up for myself. And it, the commercial, I said, actually, it's Maraniss. And he's like, wait, are you related to David Maraniss? And I said, yeah, that's my dad. And he said, I didn't know that. And it made me feel good that I actually got on the show on my own merits. Not because of that guy. And that's Harry Belafonte, who was on campus last year. And he got a copy of the book, which was fun. This is Kimberly Williams Paisley, actress and wife of Brad Paisley. And for the last 2 years, I've had the chance to be the MC at the Southern Festival of Books Authors in the Round Dinner, which Mr. Siegenthaler used to do. So that's a huge, huge honor for me. This is the Vanderbilt men's basketball team here. And I don't know if you know this, but all the freshmen on campus here are required to read the book this year. And so as part of that, the University Fine Arts Gallery had an exhibit related to the book. It closed at the end of December. But the basketball team came by, and I had a chance to tell them all about Perry Wallace. And most of these guys didn't know anything about him. They'd seen his banner hanging in the gym, but they didn't know the story. And so that was probably, for me, the most meaningful talk I've ever had the opportunity to give, was telling the current players about this guy that made things possible for them. That's Ethel Kennedy. And so and my wife, Allison, and we had a chance to go to D.C. for the RFK Book Awards, and the book received an honor there. And she was really sweet to us, and it sounded like she had read the book, so it was a huge honor. And then in the middle there, that's out at Cracker Barrel last week, and they have a diversity team. And this is a company that's had its issues with race issues and gender issues over the years. And so they invited me out there to tell Perry Wallace's story, just as an example of Vanderbilt as an institution changing, and what were the sort of the lessons learned from that. And they really enjoyed the story, and they've now invited Perry to come out there. So he'll be here in February, and he's going to come out with me to their corporate office in Lebanon. Wanted to invite all of you to come to one of these two events. And you see this book cover here. It's different than the one you've probably seen before. At the end of December, a young reader's version of the book came out, which I'm really excited about. And so Vanderbilt University Press published the original adult version. If you've heard of a local author named Ruta Sepetys, who wrote Between Shades of Gray and Salt to the Sea, she writes historical fiction. She introduced me to her editors at Penguin, and they have a young readers division called Philomel. And so I worked with them to convert the book into a book for middle school and high school kids. And it just came out at the end of December, but these are going to be the two kind of official launch events for that at Parnassus and at the Barnes & Noble in Cool Springs, if you'd be interested in coming to either one of those. And this book it's not dumbed down at all. They gave me kind of a backhanded compliment when I thought I was going to have to rewrite pretty much every sentence. And they said, oh, no, actually, your writing style will work just fine for 12-year-olds. So I was a little offended at first, but then I was happy I didn't have to rewrite the whole thing. So it's really just shorter. It's about 1/4 the length of the original book. Some of the side characters are either removed or their parts are much shorter, and some of the background on Nashville and Vanderbilt is not there. But an adult who prefers a book that's 1/4 the length would like this one just as well. Okay, then I wanted to show you guys this. This is the remaining 5 weeks of the class. And so what I thought I would do is bring in a guest speaker every week to pick up on a theme or an event from the book. So next week, we will have guys that played on either the Father Ryan or Pearl teams in 1965. And if you've read the book, that was the first integrated high school basketball game in the South, was here in Nashville in 1965 between Father Ryan and Pearl, down at Municipal Auditorium. The anticipation for the game was so big that they knew they wouldn't be able to fit the crowd in either high school gym. And actually, Memorial Gym hadn't been expanded yet, so the biggest auditorium in town was Municipal Auditorium. Really significant game. Father Ryan actually had a black player on their team named Willie Brown, who all the Pearl players knew. He lived in their neighborhood, and his girlfriend, Willie Brown of Father Ryan's girlfriend, was the captain of the Pearl High cheerleaders. So everybody knew each other. Willie Brown played a great game. He missed what would have been the game-winning shot. But his teammate, Lynn Dempsey, who hadn't played the whole game, he's in there at the end. He gets his only rebound of the game and makes his only basket as the buzzer sounds. And Father Ryan wins the game by 1 point. I think Walter Fisher is going to come from the Pearl team. Great guy. And when I told him what the subject was going to be, you could still tell that he still felt this pain that they lost that game. They only lost one more game the rest of his high school career. But okay, and then February 1st class will actually take place at the old Pearl High School, which is now the MLK Magnet School. And so those of you who take the buses over here, the bus will take you there instead of here. We'll have different buses leaving at the end of class. I know some of you take another class that's back over here. So there'll be one bus that comes back to campus, and the other shuttle will go back to the parking lot. Those of you who don't normally take the shuttles here, you can catch the shuttle to the high school at Centennial Sportsplex, where the buses pick up the other students. Or I suppose, Norma, could you just go to the school yourself, or would you prefer people take the shuttle? Yes, yes. Not much, right. So if you can go to Centennial Sportsplex and take the shuttle bus, that would be ideal. February 8th, Oren Burks, who's a football player and is my favorite current Vanderbilt student athlete, brilliant kid, will be here along with Simone Charlie, who you saw in that last picture, to talk about what life is like as a student athlete at Vanderbilt today. And then February 15th, we'll have Candace Lee, who's the deputy athletic director at Vanderbilt, African-American woman who played basketball here at Vanderbilt and can talk about the issues in college sports more generally and in the SEC. And then February 22nd, computers willing, we'll have Perry Wallace Skyping. So you'll see him up on the screen and you can ask him any questions that you'd like to. So I think that will be, yes, ma'am. Oh, we've got 9 minutes left. Okay, perfect. Well, I've got about a, would you guys like to see a 3 or 4 minute video or just go straight into questions? Video? Okay. When Vanderbilt read the book this year, Dr. Frank Dobson, who runs the Black Cultural Center here, recorded a video about what the book meant to him and what he's, the conversations that he saw it leading to here on campus, and he related it to Martin Luther King. And I think it's just a really powerful video, so I wanted to show that to you.
Strong inside, trying to help us understand. Have you ever been the first or the only one at something? Then you know what it's like to have to be strong inside. Have you ever felt lonely, even though others may have thought that you were known or popular, and perhaps even a commodity in a particular setting? Then perhaps you have had to be strong inside. In a chapter entitled Ticket Out of Town, Andrew Maraniss, the author of Strong Inside, captures the feelings Perry Wallace felt during his 4 years at Vanderbilt as a star basketball player, as a Black pioneer who broke the color barrier in the SEC, but also as a young man who felt alienated and alone. In the chapter, Maraniss discusses a news article about Perry, an interview of the star student athlete. The interview appeared in the Tennessean, and the title of the article was Lonely for Four Years for Star, They Meant Well. Within the interview, Perry Wallace, then a graduating senior, talks about the loneliness and feelings of alienation he felt during his 4 years on campus. When the article hits, campus leaders and administrators are upset, as though Perry was ungrateful, as though he was trying to besmirch Vanderbilt's name and reputation. One has to remember, of course, that it was bold for Vanderbilt to be the first school in the SEC to do what it did. But the words of head coach Roy Skinner, the man who recruited Perry, are perhaps the most telling. After reading the interview, these are the words of Coach Skinner. God, I don't know how he took it for 4 years. It was a lot worse than I thought it was. I felt for him, and I really admired him for doing it. He was just trying to help us understand. He was just trying to help us understand. I repeat those words because they bring to mind the title of the last book written by the Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., his 1967 work, Where Do We Go From Here? Chaos or Community. I would submit to you that what Perry Wallace was doing in that interview and throughout his trying 4 years on our campus is that he was challenging Vanderbilt, issuing a call to the campus that he loved, but which didn't always understand his situation. He was saying, indeed he was asking, where do we go from here, Vanderbilt, chaos or community? I know that our commitment is to community, and the voices in this book, Strong Inside, challenge us to reject chaos, the chaos wrought of difference, which we see in America and in the world today. The voices in this book compel us to seek community, no matter how difficult that may be, no matter how long it takes, like Perry Wallace's white teammate, Bob Warren, who decades later seeks out Perry to apologize for not being as much of an ally as he perhaps could have been back then. Or the voice of Godfrey Dillard, who, like Perry, was a Black student pioneer here at Vandy and an athlete, but who, unlike Perry, did not stay at Vanderbilt. The voices in the book speak to us today, trying to help us understand that the dilemma confronting us is the one which Dr. King posed in 1967 in his work, Where Do We Go From Here, Chaos or Community, which is also the year when he spoke here at Vanderbilt for the Impact Symposium. The choice is still between chaos or community, and the only way for us to choose community is to echo the sentiments of Coach Skinner and to empathize with those who might feel alienated or lonely and to realize that they are trying to help us understand their plight. This is such an important book for this time and for our campus. I am glad that we will be discussing it this year.
So we have like 5 minutes. If anyone has any questions about the book, I'd be happy to answer them. I also have brought copies of both the adult version and the kids version, if anybody is interested in those. They're $20. I'll bring them every week, so those will be here. But any questions? Yes, ma'am. Did Perry live on campus? Yes, he did. He lived, until his senior year. He moved off campus as a senior. And it wasn't really very common to move off campus at the time, but he said that at that point, his mom had died, and the campus experience had been so difficult for him that he asked Coach Skinner for permission just to kind of remove himself a little bit, and he let him do that.
I did know a lot of schools in the
grade would have counseling, and I knew he was from there. Right. Yes, he did live on campus. He wasn't. Yes, sir. No, nothing like that. And, you know, in the movie 42 about Jackie Robinson, there's a scene that I don't think is actually true. I think it's an apocryphal story, but, you know, Pee-wee Reese puts his arm around Jackie Robinson in the face of the worst heckling, I think, in Cincinnati or St. Louis, just to show, you know, the rest of the Dodgers player, we've got our teammates back. And not only did they not have extra security or anything, that scene never played out for Perry. So, I talked to Coach Skinner for the book. He never sat the team down and said, this trip is going to be difficult for our teammate. We're going to have to show some extra support for him. He felt that in his mind, the best way to treat the situation was, he thought, treat Perry just like any other player. And so that meant not doing anything extra. But, you know, the fallacy of that was Perry wasn't being treated just like any other player by anybody else in those situations. So, he said that, yes, that's the dramatic story that I tell in the book, but he said the banging around on the basketball court was pretty common, and it was hard for him at the time often to tell if it was just normal basketball or if there was something more to it. He was never physically assaulted outside of the game environment. Yes? Yes, I would say so. Yes, and Chancellor Hurd suggested it to Coach Skinner. Oh, yes, so he asked if it was Chancellor Hurd's energy that drove this decision. And I would say so for sure. He wanted to make that sort of statement. But I do think Coach Skinner deserves credit, too. So at the University of Kentucky, their president was named Oswald, and he was having similar conversations with Adolf Rupp and encouraging Adolf Rupp to integrate his team. I mean, the Kentucky football team had already integrated. The basketball team hadn't. And Coach Rupp resisted it, you know, very strongly. He didn't have his first black player until 1971. But when Coach Skinner had this conversation with Chancellor Hurd, he said, okay, you know, and Coach Skinner wasn't an especially socially conscious person or progressive figure. He was from Paducah, Kentucky. He grew up on a farm. He had never coached or played with African-American player before at any of the other levels that he had coached at, but his whole goal in life was to beat Kentucky, you know, as a Kentucky kid. And the Vanderbilt team in 65 had made it to the Elite Eight, and if not for a bad call, they would have made it to the Final Four. So he felt like he was on the verge of competing for a national championship, and if Perry Wallace could help him get there, that was fine with him. So that was his motivation. Yes. Yes, ma'am. And I have a scene. Okay. Last question. She asked if Perry talked about the influence that Coach Ridley or any of the other staff at Pearl High School had on his decision to come to Vanderbilt. And I have a scene in the book where Jimmy Davey, you remember that name, the sports writer for the Tennessean, was invited over by Coach Ridley and I believe Coach Armstrong to sit down with Perry and talk about what do you think it's going to be like for him playing in the SEC, you know, and Jimmy Davey said that, he said, I'm sure it'll be very difficult for him, but if anybody could do it, a person like Perry could do it. Perry got the impression from his parents and from Coach Ridley that they wanted him to go to Vanderbilt, that they wanted him to stay close to home and to make that history. And so he felt some pressure from them to make that decision. All right, well, thank you so much for taking this course.